Dear me, they're wasting so much money on television. They're saturating the airwaves with expensive spots that people are turned off by. But it looks like the Obama campaign just hit $181 million last month, and they are talking about $1 billion on that reelection campaign. Terry.
It's kind of crazy, isn't it?
It is crazy. It's totally
insane. Discussing things like that, doing things like that. Well, Mitt Romney is staying on the offensive, too. He's keeping up his attacks on the economy, and today he's going after the president on foreign policy. Ephraim Graham has the story.
Romney says it's time to change course in the Middle East, and he's criticizing the Obama administration's handling of last month's terrorist attacks in Libya. He also says the attacks can't be blamed on a video that criticized Islam, as the president did at first. The speech will help set the stage for the second presidential debate on both domestic and foreign policy. Mitt Romney continues to ride high on momentum gained from his first debate performance.
You all had the chance to hear his answers or his non-answers. Now, of course, days later, we're hearing his excuses. And next January, we'll be watching him leave the White House for the last time.
A Rasmussen poll shows Romney getting a debate bounce, now leading President Obama 49% to 47% among likely voters. And a forecasting model out of the University of Colorado that's predicted every election accurately since 1980 says Romney will win the Electoral College, 330 to 208. Meanwhile, President Obama is fundraising in California today. In September, Democrats raised $181 million, shattering previous records. At a celebrity fundraiser last night, President Obama made the first reference to his poor debate performance.
They just perform flawlessly, night after night. I can't always say the same.
Obama is hoping last Friday's jobs report will give him the momentum he needs going into the next round of debates. The unemployment rate fell below 8% for the first time since January of 2009, coming in at 7.8%, a number that the president says shows progress.
More Americans entered the workforce, more people are getting jobs.
But Mitt Romney says the recovery still isn't good enough.
People in this country are having a hard time finding a job. People in this country are having a hard time making ends meet, even if they do have a job.
Experts say, even with more talk of foreign policy coming in the weeks before the election, the top concern on voters' minds in November will be economic issues like jobs and unemployment. Ephraim Graham, CBN News.
It looks like Romney's rolling along now. That debate dispelled the miasma that had been thrown upon him by all the false advertising that was put out by Obama. The thing, Terry, that I'm so amazed at is that he keeps sticking with this $5 trillion tax cut. Romney said, I didn't propose any $5 trillion tax cut. Well, they found some study that said, well, over 10 years, it is estimated that if the Romney policies continue as they are stated, it will amount to a $5 trillion tax cut. Romney didn't say that. He's not advocating that. And these people just cooked it up, and Obama acts like it's really the real thing. And he continues to say it over and over again. And Romney says, that's not my plan. And then the Chicago spinmeisters come back and say, well, he's lying. Well, he's not lying. He's not following your playbook. And I think the American people are smart enough to realize that.
Well, you know, I think the reaction immediately after the debate was reality. Everybody was flustered, even those in the Obama camp, even those who were speaking and saying somehow that he'd won the debate. There was just a hollowness to it. Well, so there's been time to spin it, and I guess that's what we'll see from now till.
It's the altitude in Denver, and you know, he may have a point. I mean, some people were blogging, well, maybe the president was smoking a little weed. I mean, they've got all kinds of...
I missed that one.
You look at all those blogs, all those tweets, but anyhow. Next one, he'll be a lot sharper on it, but... his main thing is that they killed Osama bin Laden, but what about Libya? He's got a lot of egg on his face on that one.
Israel
is a clear cover-up on the Libyan attack on our embassy that killed our ambassador. Well, Something else is going on. The churches say we're not going to stand for it. We're having our freedom taken away. But I want everybody to understand that the IRS is not acting on its own. It is acting on the basis of a piece of legislation that was jammed through the Congress by President Lyndon Johnson, which limits the ability of nonprofits to speak out in an election. In my opinion, it's unconstitutional, and it hasn't been challenged as it should, but the pastors are saying, all right, we're going to go and we're going to challenge it. So the presidential election was a topic of conversation from an unusual place. That's the pulpit, and Lee Webb has that story from the CBN newsroom. Lee.
Pat, pastors across the country, as you indicated, took part in something called Pulpit Freedom Sunday. They believe they have the freedom to talk openly about politics from the pulpit, even the right to speak for or against the candidates. And for one Sunday at least, they were willing to test the federal government's resolve to stop them. John Jessup reports.
Bishop Harry Jackson is known for speaking his mind. On Sunday, he took it a step further, delivering a fiery sermon about the country's state of affairs.
Something ain't right in America.
And breaking the law by delivering a message designed to influence the 2012 election.
The title of our message that we give you in these last few minutes is four reasons why I cannot support Barack Obama for president.
Bishop Jackson used an Old Testament text to make his case, drawing a parallel to King Ahab and Queen Jezebel and their attempts to silence the prophets of God. In the end, Bishop Jackson says, justice and righteousness prevailed, but only after God's people spoke out. During the service, he argued against re-electing the president based on major sticking points like abortion, same-sex marriage, the U.S.-Israeli alliance, and threats to religious liberty. Jackson also endorsed a Maryland pro-life Republican running for Congress and spoke out against the statewide referendum that would make same-sex marriage legal in Maryland. For his members, his words were timely.
I agreed with everything, that we've been pushed back far enough. It's time to show our heart, not only to the world, but to God himself, that we're not going to be cowards and we can't surrender the grace and goodness and mercies that he has given us.
But they also defied a decades-old regulation that allows churches and charitable organizations to operate as tax-exempt so long as they don't directly or indirectly participate in any political campaigning on behalf or against any candidate. If they do, churches risk losing their tax-exempt status. The goal, according to the IRS, is to place candidates for office beyond the reach of pastors speaking from the pulpit. But a growing number of conservative religious leaders are taking a stand against the regulation.
Pulpit Freedom Sunday started 4 years ago with a little more than 30 pastors participating. This year, that number skyrocketed to an estimated 1,500, with each of the pastors pledging to record their sermons and send them to the IRS. For Bishop Jackson, though, he says he's less concerned about a government audit than he is about public backlash against him and his congregation.
The backlash and the retribution, if you would, that can come from that community in the greater Washington, D.C. area is much more intimidating than the IRS in terms of my members have to deal with what other people say.
Critics, even some clergy, say it's more important to lift up the name of Jesus than political candidates. But for Bishop Jackson and others, they say the issues at stake are too grave to remain silent.
I believe that we have to have a reasoned biblical approach for why you would choose a Romney, for example. And I'm not going to wait forever. I finally came to the conclusion that you can't just lay out a case and not name names.
John Jessup, CBN News, Beltsville, Maryland.
Pat, you have to admire their resolve.
Well, I admire it. It's a little quixotic, I tell you. Lee, I've fought that battle. I've been there in the trenches. I lobbied Congress on changing the law, I asked them to put in about three or four words in the IRS code and to just insert the thing to an insubstantial amount of their activity. And I was all set, I had it all teed up to go, and then lo and behold, Newt Gingrich was found to be involved in politicking a history course at some little college down in Georgia, and that became this focus. And then they said, well, rather than it looked like this is in favor of Newt, we're not going to do anything. And so Congress punted. And it's there. It should be changed. It was rammed through without debate. It was rammed through without committee analysis of the legislation. It was put through because Lyndon Johnson was a tyrant. He had tyrannical control over the United States Senate. And it's the so-called Johnson Amendment. That's what did it. But now the law says that any statement by a nonprofit in behalf of or in opposition to a candidate for public office can result in the revocation of tax-exempt status. Now, I think churches have a constitutional freedom to talk about these things. They've had it since the founding of our republic, and it's something that they need to speak out about, but it's like the nail that sticks up. It's going to get a hammer slammed on it. But whether the IRS is going to sit passively by and let this go on, they probably will because they don't want the hassle. But nevertheless, they're merely following what the law says. And regrettably, the law is wrong, and it shouldn't have been that way. And in my opinion, it's unconstitutional. But the challenges have been many, and I've been involved in trying to get constitutional amendments and to get an amendment. But all we're talking about, to an insubstantial amount of its activity, that's all we were asking to put into the law. It's an absolute prohibition now, which means that the IRS has a gun at the head of a nonprofit, and they can pull the trigger and destroy you on the strength of just somebody comes out and says, I favor the election of Obama or Romney. That's all they've got to say. The IRS can come on top of them. I don't know.
I admire, as Lee said.
You admire them, but why don't we need to change the cotton picking law? It's wrong. It shouldn't have been put in, and there needs to be enough courage in the United States Congress to change it. But as I say, I have been there, done that, failed, Lee.
California Governor Jerry Brown is trying to bring down gas prices in his state by relaxing some regulations temporarily. Prices jumped an average of 16 cents to a record $4.65 a gallon. That is the most expensive fuel in the nation. Some stations charging more than $5, and at least one in the Golden State went over $6. Experts blame last month's fire at a gas refinery and pipeline problems in Southern California. But many drivers aren't buying that.
I think it's just outrageous.
Okay.
And I'm not sure what the reason is for that, and I don't believe what is being purported.
It's just a matter of we're going to just soak you a little bit more, and you know, they don't care.
Yeah, Governor Brown has ordered state smog regulators to allow a cheaper winter blend of gasoline to be produced a month early. You would wonder, Pat, if this was going on in a swing state, what impact this might have on the election.
Well, it would have a profound impact because it would mitigate against the president. But again, Lee, that's one I've been there and done that. You know, I tell you, in my 80-some years, I've done a lot of things, and one of which was I would never counsel anybody to do, but I was foolish enough to buy a refinery and oil refinery in California, and it was sufficiently productive to have changed the balance of the equation in California. It was going to supply independent stations in the San Diego area, and it would have been a nice balance. So if one of those other refineries went down, this would have been supplying the margin. There was a group called the Citizens for a Better Environment. They brought a lawsuit. The lawsuit was upheld by a left-wing judge. I say left-wing. He was appointed by, I think, Bill Clinton. But he was solidly against refineries. And the idea was, this judge said, if you want to open this refinery, you've got to go for what's called new source review, which means you've got to go back to square one and spend millions and millions and millions of dollars on environmental studies to prove that you won't harm the environment. That's even though the EPA had cleared this refinery, everybody had cleared the refinery, but this one lawsuit by this one group, Citizens for a Better Environment, stopped it cold, and of course it couldn't continue because the money wasn't there to keep it going. Therefore, the price of gasoline in California has gone up because there was no escape valve. But that's what happens when these greens, these environmentalists, get their hands on things. They don't care about the effect on driving. All they want to do is cut down the emissions from refineries. They don't like certain manufacturing. They just don't like it. And therefore, there's a type of blend that the California Air Resource Board wants. The CARB standards are very restrictive. And the refineries have to blend in a particular way. And so you nice folks in California are going to be paying $5 a gallon or $5.50 or $6 or however much. And you're going to be paying a lot more for your electricity because of environmental activists. And if you like that, well, you continue and you continue to pay in the pump. Others say we can't stand it. People are fleeing California, and they lost a lot of jobs because of this. But this is the price we pay. And of course, they say, well, but there's so much smog in the valley, it's so bad in Los Angeles, that we've got to do something to curb emissions, and so this is our answer. Well, God bless you, Lee.
Pat, the Philippines government and the country's largest Muslim rebel group have reached a preliminary peace agreement. It is considered a major breakthrough toward ending a decades-long Muslim insurgency that's left more than 120,000 people dead. Philippines President Benigno Aquino announced the deal with the Moro Islamic Liberation Front. Aquino says the deal paves the way now for a final and enduring peace in Mindanao. Western governments worry the rebel strongholds would become breeding grounds for al-Qaeda-affiliated extremists. The new television season here in the U.S. will see an increase in the number of gay and bisexual characters on the small screen. The Gay and Lesbian Alliance Against Defamation says it will be the highest level ever. 4.4% of actors on primetime are portraying lesbian, gay, bisexual, or transgender characters. That's up from 2.9% last season. ABC has the highest amount with 10 out of 194 characters. CBS also has more gay characters this season. Well, businessmen are getting out of France before new tax increases hit, and that means high-end real estate is hitting the market. Financial advisors and real estate agents tell Agency France Press that expensive homes are coming up for sale in Paris and across France. Incoming socialist President Francois Hollande is raising the tax rate to 75%. That's right, 75% on incomes above €1 million per year for the next 2 years. That, by the way, is about $1.3 million. And many in business are concerned about possible future tax hikes. Some complain about a growing attitude against free enterprise in France. Whew, I'm glad I'm talking about France there. For a minute, I thought we were talking about the United States, Pat.
It'll come to that if we continue the policies of the current administration. But nevertheless, it probably won't get as bad as France. But nevertheless, you know, the group that's getting hit hard are the tech entrepreneurs, the ones who are starting new businesses, because they're trying to raise the capital gains tax, and that'll make it really hard. So if they want to sell some of their stock or cash out, they can't get the big payoffs that they get here in the United States. And so they're moving. Brussels is close by. You just get on a train and you're up the road in an hour or so. You're out of France. And they can leave, you know, and they don't have to hang around. And they can start their business anywhere they want to. And they can go to Monte Carlo. They can go to Singapore. Or they can go to Geneva or wherever and get a decent deal. So these governments that think they can turn the screws on rich people are very misguided because the rich can flee. And some of you here in the United States might think of fleeing if the problems continue.
Well, this is one European trend you hope doesn't make it across the Atlantic.
Well, it's there. I mean, it's the concept of regulating business, that business is evil, and we have to squeeze it and make it pay its, quote, fair share. Once you start talking fair share, nobody knows what a fair share is, but once you start talking fair share, and then it's up to the bureaucrat to decide what's fair. Is it 50%, 60%, 75%? The French say it's 75%. I was over there some years ago talking to a French businessman, and he told me all the various taxes, they were paying over 100%.
Good grief.
Property tax, they had taxes on capital, on shares, on property, on transactions of every kind, and they got taxes on workers, and it goes on down the line. And no French businessman in his right mind would hire anybody because of the onerous labor requirements. So socialism can kill itself, so that's the good news. It'll kill itself because it cannot survive.
But what happens in between?
In between is tough.
Venezuela's President Hugo Chavez has won re-election in his tightest race yet. Chavez faced a tough challenge from former state governor Enrique Capriles. He promised to take on violent crime, the bureaucracy, and government corruption. But in the end, Chavez was winning by nearly 10 points with 90% of the vote counted. Chavez told his supporters that, quote, the revolution has triumphed. This was his third re-election victory in nearly 14 years in office. CBN's Orphans Promise is supporting a special orphanage in Mongolia. The orphanage focuses on bringing emotional and spiritual healing to abandoned and special needs children. It also helps prepare children to live in a family unit. Efforts are made to reunite children with their parents once their home life is safe, but it's also been the leading orphanage in Mongolia for placing children in loving homes. Orphans Promise sponsored a month-long summer camp this year for the children at the orphanage. You can find out more about what CBN is doing around the world by logging on to cbn.com/international.